Step back, dudes! I just brought us some heavy artillery!
Donnie! Long time! Leo, how's it going?
Hey, Casey! Welcome back!
Hey, Ralph, how'd your brain implant go? Good?
What?
Funny.
Anyway, enough of this, camaraderie. When do we get together and bust some skulls?
Welcome to the Real Comic Heroes Podcast. Your adventure into the world of comic book movies starts here.
Greetings, citizens, and welcome to another adventure of the Real Comic Heroes Podcast. My name is Travis.
And I'm Patrick, joining with a special guest today.
It's me, Dave, from 5 Minutes of Mystery.
Welcome back, Dave.
Thank you for having me back on. I'm glad we get some shell power in here.
That's right. We had you on. Okay. What's that?
I said okay. So he's here under his own volition.
Travis asked, and I said no. I said because I'm never going to get on TMNT Minute. It's just not happening. I'm not cool enough. It's literally the Thanos meme of like, I would like to guest, and they go, I don't even know who you are. So that's fine. All right, so I was more than excited when Travis actually asked me, hey, you want to do Turtles 3, the unofficial Turtles in Time movie? I said, yeah, sure.
Yeah, or as I referred to it, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles III.
Yeah, that honestly, God, that's a pain in the ass. It's a pain in the ass to actually search that, because you're right.
Yeah.
You have to actually put in, IMDb doesn't help you. I go, come on. The first one's like TMNT 3, nothing. I'm like, really? And it's like, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 3. Still nothing. Like, it puts the games above it. Yeah, and you're like, okay fine. I. And then it finally comes up. So, and then some even call it Teenage Mutant Turtles, Turtles in Time. They don't call it that. And I was like, guys, we gotta get this together.
At some point, this was rebranded as Turtles in Time because it definitely was not Turtles in Time.
No.
You know, when it first came out. This was
the game. Turtles 4. That's
I thought so too.
Video game arcade series. So that makes it even more confusing. It goes, oh, Turtles in Time. You're talking about Turtles in Time the 4. And that's a great game. But it's like, no, it's not what we're talking about. Ironically, I don't think there even is a Shogun level in that game. You go like to Wild West. You go to Caveman. I think you go to like the future, maybe. So you go to like at least 3 or 4 times. None of it's Shogun, I believe. So there's no cross promotion.
Yeah.
This movie was thrown together at best. The taglines alone had left me.
Oh man,
my head scratching.
I'm sure when I wrote this down, just preparing to actually hit play and start watching it, I wrote down TMNT 3. Are we really doing this?
All right. What's the? Are we doing an introduction? Because I'm ready to talk, but at the same time, are we ready to talk?
We'll do. Patrick will hit us with some taglines.
Okay.
And then.
Don't want to.
What's that?
Don't want to.
Do it. You got to do your part, Pat. Do your part.
Yeah. Hit us with those sweet marketing taglines.
All right, it sucks right out the bat. I'm just going to warn you.
Okay.
All right, here we go. Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles 3, the most exciting adventure in 400 years, except it wasn't 400 years ago. So right off the bat, they lost me.
Wow. If they hadn't added the except it wasn't 400 years ago thing... Unless that was you adding that.
That was me.
Oh, okay.
That was me.
Okay. It wouldn't put it past me if... Right. Yeah.
Because what was it? On the screen it said Japan 1603.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
And it's supposed to be 1993, so a little off.
Yeah.
And then we have the infamous Turtles in Time. So it was a tagline that made its way into everyone's brain, apparently, because I thought it was Turtles in Time.
It's a good brainworm of a title, sure.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, that, and it's like the only thing you remember about the third one is that it was a time travel.
Right.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, even my wife asked me what movie we were talking about, and I said, you know, the third Ninja Turtle movie, and she said, "Who's the bad guy in that?" I was like, "Well, it's the one where they go back in time." And she was like, "They go back in time?" So if you don't know it as Turtles in Time, maybe that, I don't know, maybe it's, I don't know.
Either way, it sucks.
Yeah.
Then we have The Turtles Are Back in Time.
I'm okay with that one. That one's fine.
Not too bad. All right. Then we have They're Back in Time for Their Newest Movie Adventure.
No, too long.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Back in Time. End of sentence. Like,
that works as a spoken TV commercial, like, you know, as in promo, but.
Mm-hmm. All right. This one, I'm not entirely sure if maybe it's a typo, because it does say Ancient Japan, 1593, without a map, without a clue, without a pizza.
Okay.
So that's definitely like, but someone in the team forgot how many hundred years are going back.
Yeah. They were just trying to make the math work so it was an even hundred, you know.
Like, yeah. They just didn't tell the guy.
Yeah.
Plug it in the Japan 1603.
He's like, open up Encarta, trying to figure it out.
Yeah.
And that's all we got.
Okay.
Not too much to choose from. The simplest one is probably the best one.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, why don't we go around, and does anyone remember seeing this the first time? What's everyone's history with this one?
Well, I saw it in the theater.
Okay.
I was utterly disappointed. And I remember being really confused about the Casey Jones thing.
Mm.
Because I was like, did he go back?
Right. Because
that was like April. I'm like, is that Casey?
Right.
And then I don't know. It was just so like confusing because I kept jumping all over the place from one time to the next. And then I didn't really care about the movie as I was watching it.
Yeah.
Like the bad guy was lame. He was just some frilly dressed dude.
Mm-hmm.
And the turtles looked weird to me
for some reason.
I think it was mostly their mouth. And that still holds up. FYI. But I remember this kind of ending me ever wanting to see a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle movie again.
Yeah.
I leaned more on the cartoon.
Sure.
And the awful NES game that I hated with a passion because I couldn't beat the water level.
Yep. Mm. Yep.
God, I don't remember ever playing it. It's kind of the same. Well, I don't think I saw this in theater. I don't remember seeing this in theater, which is kind of weird, given how much I loved the first one and still really like the second one. It's weird. Like, I saw this one on VHS for the first time, and as a kid, like, never watched it again. I think I saw this one other time, you know, probably in the days of like when you could rent Blockbuster DVDs by mail, like right before Netflix. Like, I think maybe I rented this then just to like see it again, or maybe I caught it on like on DVR or something. But so I know I've seen most, if not all of this, you know, a second time. So I guess now being the third time, but
yeah, this is my second time.
Yeah. It's so weird that as a kid, I didn't want to watch this one again, you know? Yeah. So that's my history with it. Saw it and just kind of forgot about it. What about you, Dave?
I think this is a Blockbuster rental. The older I get, the more I believe that when I was a child, I don't think my parents took me to the movie theaters more than maybe two or three times a year, like maybe for a birthday. But I'm sitting here, I'm going like, I've never seen these movies, but I don't think I saw them in theater. I think my parents were just like, oh, we'll just do a Blockbuster. And so I think I probably saw this and all the other ones with that, or like I was given the tape maybe for Christmas or for a birthday. The one thing I just remember is I love the soundtrack. I was like, this soundtrack is awesome. Like, I remember that ZZ Top intro. I'm a kid and I'm like dancing to that because they're dancing to it on stage or on the screen. And I'm just like, oh my God, this guitar riff's awesome. And like April's, like all her music and her tape player, I thought these were all just banger hits. Even the guys at the honor guard at the end were like dancing to Tarzan Boy. So the music worked for me. So I love the music of this. come on, you have to put it in perspective as a kid listening to these like 90s and like late 80s rocks.
Oh, for sure.
This movie is utterly 90s. Yeah.
And so I think, but I know I definitely watched the first two movies more. I know that.
Yeah.
I just remember there's a time where I watched all three over a weekend, and I was like, yeah, the third one's the weakest. And I just remember there was a time in the late 90s where the Turtles did stop. Like, I felt like the Turtles just stopped, and there wasn't more media made for it. Like, I don't see the cartoon any farther. This is before, like, the Nickelodeon and then the TMNT, like, kind of reboot in, like, the mid-2000s, I think, got pick up steam. And then the Bay films, which I never watched the Bay films. I didn't like... I kind of felt like... I was like, all right, Bay, you're doing to the Turtles what you did to the Transformers. Mm. But I'm not impressed because I was... Even as a kid, I was like... I respected the suits. As a kid, I even respected the suits more than I did CGI. And I was like... I was half and half on the third film's costumes, their heads. I thought Raph's head was okay, and I thought Donatello's head was okay, but I didn't care for Leo and Michelangelo's.
Mm.
For some reason, I was like the two of them I was okay with when they articulated points. The other two I didn't care for. I felt like I felt like their earlier costumes looked better.
Oh yeah,
but
Splinter was terrifying.
Oh man, he.
And this one, it looks like it's. Bad. I'm thinking. I honestly think this one and three is like left over from maybe two or something. Because he looks
could be
even for an old rat sensei, he looks too worn out.
Yeah,
and I'm thinking he was a prop that was like they found the warehouse and they great, we don't have to rebuild him, and they just propped him in a chair and they're like, all right, we don't have to animatronic his whole body or anything.
He looks like Splinter looks like he belongs in a knockoff Chuck E. Cheese, but not like a knockoff Chuck E. Cheese as it's open and running, but one that's been condemned for like 7 years. And you go in and you turn on the lights and everything's covered in dust, and you just find this, rat that's like just falling apart. And
yeah, it's like
that's even, Splinter in this movie.
Like Splinter, even though you're a rat, you live in the sewer. Like, he's smart enough that he would have hygiene, is what I'm trying to get at.
Run a comb through that thing.
Like, yeah, I don't see Splinter being a guy who, like, oh, yeah, I'm just going to, like, I'm a rat and I'm, I'm in the sewers. No, like, he's an intelligent, creature. And he would be intelligent enough to, like, I'm going to clean myself.
Yeah.
And I just feel like the prop department found him and just put him there and did, yeah, you're right, and didn't try to polish him in any way, and it does show. He looks old and decrepit, and that's not part of his character in this movie. Like it's not like where he's in danger of health or anything. He's just
He doesn't look like the character is old and decrepit. It looks like the puppet is old and
Yes, he doesn't. He has I'm gonna say he has more energy, but like the first movie. Splinter, how he talks and how he acts seems very like he's on his last legs, and then he gets captured by Splinter and you're like, holy crap, like there's a whole plot he might die, and like the Turtles have to think about losing him. And the second one, I don't remember too much with him outside of like him in April's apartment, and like I don't remember too much of what Splinter did in the second one.
He mentors Kino a little bit and then is just kind of in the background when they're getting ready to go take on the Shredder and whatever, and he's there at the very end to do his little joke.
I feel like he definitely kind of fades away in the third act to make room for Token Razor, and then he just shows up when they get this hideout. And that's the thing, the second movie set up an amazing hideout. And this third film like shows it's like we're gonna deliver on this hideout, but then we don't leave it, and that's what pisses me off. We don't leave this hideout. I'm sorry. We're getting past introductions. Yeah. Where are we now?
I can do this
all day.
Oh yeah. Well, like we said, it starts off in this big red sunset or sunrise, or it puts us in Japan in 1603, And the first thing I thought was in this, you know, opening shot and then the little chase that ensues, it's beautifully shot.
Yeah. Like,
mm-hmm. That sun with the silhouettes of the riders coming up over the hills, and then the chase, and a couple other upcoming things. Like, they're actually trying things here that I can't, as much as I love the first movie and, you know, have some fondness for the second, I can't think of anything visually stunning with those movies. You know, maybe in the first one, there's some cool effects or cool shots with Shredder and kind of revealing him, but really nothing, you know, adventurous, I guess, with
Well, that movie played with shadows well. I will say that.
Yeah.
First,
yeah,
we had a great shadow play. Yeah. Second one felt a little afternoon television.
Yeah.
And you're right. The third one opens with some great, you know, exterior shots. And I think the people who did the cam work, and I think the people who did the outdoor Japan setting, I think, did a great job. I think the mm-hmm. sets are great. So props to them. It didn't feel like a fake laboratory. Like in 2, it feels a little too fake, the laboratory.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm so – and this sewer setting is here, really great.
Yeah. Here they do a really cool thing, and I noticed it was in the trailer as well. We cut from, you know, feudal Japan, and it takes us into the, you know, 1993, and the camera does like this Dutch angle alongside the a subway car comes rushing past you, and that's a cool shot. You know, they don't do it. I think they do it one more time in the movie. Like, they think they kind of reuse that shot, but
it's a good way to.
It's a cool effect, yeah.
To let you know what timeline you're in without having to do any more. It's a quick, easy establishing shot. Boom.
Yeah.
You're in New York subways. Got
yeah,
it.
Yeah. So I was kind of surprised right off the bat with that. And then, you know, then we meet the turtles in this movie. I guess before that.
Breakfast
before
Club
that with,
entrance?
What's that? Yeah.
The Breakfast Club entrance with their tap dance.
Yep.
But that's okay. Like, turtles watch TV all the time. Like, I'm okay with their Dennis Miller level references. Like, they watch. When they're not fighting, you know, other enemies and ninjas, they're watching television. That's perfectly fine. If anything, the turtles are a good way for kids to learn how to do annoying movie references.
Oh, yeah. Because
you're just like, I watched the turtles how they did it, and I'm a kid, and I do it now. You know, it's just... Yeah. So it's like a weird, like, yeah, this is the... It's like you get your movie references from either how the turtles did it or how Mystery Science Theater does it.
Yeah, we get a few of those. I definitely wrote down Schwing.
God.
I was like, oh, okay, we're doing that now, are we?
Yeah.
But for another topic.
When Mikey talks about vibes, I was like, I think vibes have come back, too. When he was like, oh, vibes in here are totally not good. I was like, that's been come around. Like, since, 2019, vibe, the phrasing, checking that vibe, has definitely come back around. So
yeah.
Mikey was a little ahead of the curve figuring that out. Like, that was going to be a good line.
I blame ghost adventure shows. They talk about vibes and feelings a lot. So
yeah, because they stayed up and watched all these movies the same way the turtles did. Yeah,
yeah. I think introducing the turtles in this movie with this kind of dance party thing is, on one hand, it's really lame. They look terrible. I really dislike the way they looked. I think they're. The suits grew on me by the middle of the movie. I kind of came around on the body, but I never liked the heads in this movie. I think they've just taken several steps back as far as they're slightly more expressive, I guess, than the first movie. But the first movie just nailed the look of them. You know, there's nothing. It just doesn't compare to that.
And the shadow play in the first one. Like, hides enough of their weaknesses that it gives them more depth. They also feel too thin, and the only thing I can think of is that they made these thin, and then they put them in samurai armor, and they look more accurately bulked.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because, they definitely looked more humanoid, leg-wise especially,
Yeah.
Than in previous iterations where they're kind of stockier. Okay.
I don't like the Bay ones. I think the Bay ones are too big.
Oh yeah,
it's like yeah, monsters. These guys can't fit. Yeah. They can't fit in an elevator. They couldn't fit in the sewer. Like they're way too yeah. big. And I said like I didn't care for their CGI faces. They didn't look right. It looked like they looked too Shrek-y.
Yeah,
they need to have beaks. They didn't have beaks. They just had mouths and small noses. At least they made beak jokes in this. It's like yeah, they're turtles. Like they have dumb face beaks because they're turtles. Yes. So what else? I think I'm a little pissed is that, you know, I honestly feel like the writer of the Japanese story did a really good job of like, it got a little overblown at times. Like there was a little too much plot going in where you're like, guys, yeah. This is a kid's movie. But I was like, okay, like, I don't know. Kids don't know how Japan worked in 1600. So you gotta, right. you gotta work them slowly into it where it's like, there is no governing system. There's just generals and warlords, and they want to take over towns by, like, you know, like, I, as a 30-year-old, I finally watched it, and I found, overall, I like this plot finally. Like, it, but I had to be an adult, and I already had to know how feudal Japan worked, because as a kid, I'm just like, why are they doing this? I'm just like, oh, they're an adult. Oh, feudal Japan was just like this. Was it Shogun Total War taught me. This is how it worked back then. It was, there was no, like, and then England finally came in and was just like, no, you gotta get your shit together. You know, like, and that's the thing that we didn't get, like, you know, why are there pirates here? Well, it's because, like, nobody was dealing with Japan until, like, yeah, until the 1600s when the empire figured out how to, like, you know, go around all the capes and stuff and get to Japan.
Yeah.
I remember being confused and thinking the turtles were gonna be bad based on the
prophecy map. Thing?
Prophecy,
okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I thought like there was going to be a part where they turned evil or something. Like,
oh, wow.
Well, I kept waiting for something bad to happen, but...
Huh. Well, that's interesting.
I
like the... Go ahead.
Okay. No, I want to... No, you go your point, because I'm starting to load my chambers for Lord Norinaga.
Okay.
So you do what you got to do. I'm loading my chamber. I'm getting ready. Okay. Ready to go off.
Well, I like dipping back into the past, kind of the way we have before the turtles go back in time, when we're still kind of setting up, we find this prince, maybe I guess Norinaga's not a king or whatever, but, you know, his son who is being chased at the start, and they finally bring him back to the castle, and then they strangely introduce... Walker. He comes riding in, and then Kenjin. Kenji?
Ken. They call him Ken a few times, but yeah, Kenji. Yeah.
So it's him and his father are having words, and his father is dismissing him, and or he's about to, you know, seemingly cut his head off, and then Walker shoots this giant bell and creates, you know, the distraction or why it's weird to me that they introduced Walker this way, because I didn't know that Norinaga didn't know Walker was there. You know, why show him moments before when it's not clear to us that Norinaga doesn't even know he's there? Like, it seemed like it was, you know, I don't know. It seems like someone rides on a horse. It's like, you kind of might know that they're there in the, you know, this square, but. Just that felt weird to me. Like, why are we being introduced to this character? They have history, but I don't know. It just felt weird. Like, introduce them in a slightly different way.
They really should have showed Walker's ship. They never showed a pirate ship, even in an establishing shot.
And I think
a detriment to the movie. I think we needed to show a scene of Walker in his ship, on his ship. It's like, show an establishing shot of, like, here's the ship down. Because, like, when he falls, we still don't see the ship. And that pissed me off. It's like, where is he escaping to if we don't see the ship?
Show me
the geography of, like, have a wide shot. Because they fucking showed Norinaga's castle.
Yeah.
And they don't show where a pirate ship would have docked. So show me that.
There's that beautiful sequence where Walker and his men are... doing like target practice on the beach, and it is a beautiful sequence where he's painting, you know, still life of flowers and testing cannons and all that stuff. Yeah, you could paint in a matte painting of a ship, you know, out in the, you know, anchored off in the harbor or something like that.
Yeah, because if we saw that, or at least like an establishing shot and then like show like a close, and then we have a set of him in his captain's quarters. I think if we get to see Walker in his captain's quarters, rather than him just traipsing around the temple and the castle, I think it would have helped a lot of getting more story out of Walker. Because like I'm in my 30s, I finally am understanding. It's like, okay, Norinaga thought Walker was dead because he thought his ship crashed. He's like, no, I survived my ship crash. So it starts you off with this weird thing like, all right, they know each other and he's trying to buy gunpowder because he wants to do his war. And I'm like, okay, this is a little like confusing for a child. I'm 30 years old and I get it.
Yeah.
And also, like, here's another thing. We don't, you know, I'm sure you talked about this in the second film. I am glad that they got to use their weapons in this.
Yeah.
Because they pulled it back. And maybe they said, hey, it's Feudal Japan. Like, we need to have the swords and we need to have weapons. And like, maybe they're like, and like, the bad guys are going to have guns. And so maybe they were able to use that angle to tell like the moms against turtle weapons or whatever they're going to call themselves. Where it's like, hey, you know, like, your kids, like, you know, they may hit each other with swords or something, but, like, you know, we got to show Feudal Japan's going to be like this. It's like a war. So maybe this is a good way for them. They were able to skirt around it and show, like, tell a good story. Like, I do think this story is good. I think it's a little complex, and we don't get a lot explained from it. We get a lot of the same sets and shots turned over.
Sure. Something that just occurred to me as we were talking about, you know, why not show the pirate ship? Or I don't even know if they're pirates. They're probably
privateers.
Sanctioned.
No, that's all it is. By the way, anyone curious what the difference between a privateer and a pirate is, privateer is a pirate that has a writ from a country saying you're allowed to fuck shit up. That's it. It is a writ of paper saying England is allowing you to screw over Portugal ships or Portuguese ships or Spanish ships or Colombian ships and vice versa. Like, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It's all it is that you are hired and you may fly that flag while you're doing stuff.
Right.
So that's but really
respectable businessman.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
You're like, oh, I'm a respectable businessman. I got to take all your cargo and maybe I'll like take your people too as slavers. It's just like so either way, these guys are scum. Like, clearly they're scum.
Yeah.
But
occurred to me. No, it's okay. What just occurred to me was the reason they didn't do all that work is because Hook came out in 1991. Hook did all the work for them of showing what pirates are like.
Okay.
So as long as they say, you know, our ship and shipwreck, and as long as they look like pirates, and Walker kind of has the frilly, you know, he looks enough like a pirate, I bet that's why they didn't bother too much with ships and, you know, any of that stuff.
Yeah, I mean, that's a good point. I guess we're just all bummed out that, like, we couldn't get any establishing shot of the ship.
That might have been a better, once they neutralized Norinaga at the end, then the final conflict with Walker could have taken place on a pirate ship. I'd like to see Ninja Turtles on a pirate ship, you know?
Yeah, I think that was one of the levels, I think, at some point.
I think so, okay.
Do a swashbuckling level, and, like, kids would have loved it, like,
because
then they could have had their samurai swords, and the pirates could have had, like, their swashbuckling sabers or something. Like, now the guns are out of business, they're too close quarters, now we gotta get to sabers. Like, my goodness!
Ugh.
And they could, like, the guy who gets the music, like, he could try to, like, make a cheating, like, a Goonies, like, song. Like, he could try to cheat and make a half Goonies, you know? There's a lot of these simple things I really feel like, because the very end of this is kind of is sloppy.
Yeah. The thing I'd like about... I like the time travel element here. You know, it's set up goofy. It's like, oh, I found this antique, you know, here. It's for Splinter. I guess it's a lamp or something like that. And
timer.
That's fine and everything. What I like about it is that it's body swap time travel, which I've never seen before, I don't think.
That's true. That element, we do not get body swap time travel, like, ever. Like, I watched a lot of Dark, and they could have done it, and they don't do it.
Okay.
So are we to believe that Kenshin weighs the same as April O'Neil?
Well, that's, you know...
And the turtles weigh the same as the Honor Guard?
Right, right.
Because...
Well, I think about it, an Honor Guard samurai with all of his gear might weigh the same amount as a five-foot naked turtle. Yeah.
Possible.
I don't know.
Yeah,
yeah, we're fudging the numbers here.
Yeah, know. Yeah. And it's like selective accessories, too, because April gets to keep her Walkman. He gets to keep his sword. They swap clothes, you know. So it's obviously they're going to – it's, I guess, fun to cross-dress them, you know, because it's
– because the turtles get to keep their bandana.
Right.
The eye covering.
Yeah.
Which is another form
of
clothing.
And the Honor Guard, I think they get to keep, like, their, like, hair – their hair knots and stuff.
Mm-hmm. Probably, yeah.
And their fancy one-piece underwear.
Yeah. You know,
except for Michelangelo's. He luckily had boxers.
But, no, he respectively. I think that was really smart, Michelangelo.
Oh, yeah, that was fun.
I know.
Like, he was actually thinking about the guy. He's like, guys, we're gonna body swap. Can we at least give these guys some dignity for their pants? And they're like, waving them off. Like, come on.
No time.
Yeah, it's like, guys, we knew this was coming. Like, Mikey playing his pants out. Like, you guys couldn't play in pants?
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. I was like, Mikey's considerate for once, and everyone's dumping on him. Yeah.
So here's another thing, where we talk about the what do you call them? The Daigo. What do they call those? Oh,
the
shoot.
Daimo,
I think. Yeah. Because Norinaga makes it sound like this was a legend. It's either a prophecy or it's a legend. And I got confused.
It's a legend.
It's weird.
Ancestors were
fighting them?
Defeated by the...
Okay.
Kappas or whatever.
Yeah.
So it almost makes it sound like is that coincidentally they're the same, or I don't know, because it makes it sound like that, like his ancestors lost to him, so that's why he's probably overcompensating in his war, because he doesn't want to he wants to redeem his ancestor. So I get that. And then when
he's afraid that it's going to repeat itself or something, like he's on the verge of the power that his ancestor was on, and then he's. Turtles show up,
which I mean, like, which you can add, you can add, like, the time, you know, like the fates of time, like, purposely are swapping these characters out because they need to, like, lessons have to be taught, and so you take out his Honor Guard and you take out his son, which are, like, you know, the biggest chess pieces in Norinaga's, you know, his campaign, and then you add our turtles in and April, and they, you know, help disrupt his plans and walkers. So maybe it's like not just coincidental thing, it's also like, you know,
it makes him a little sloppier or a little more on edge, because if he's already worrying about walker and trying to take out villagers, and now he has this prophesied, you know, turtle legend thing, demon, now it's like, oh, I have to worry about this too, you know.
I think, but another problem, like, is I really wish we had Kenji and I can't remember the rebel fighter lady, her name was
Mitsu.
Yeah. They didn't have them talk early in the film when he was being chased, because like they had a different guy, like, you know, because I guess they were like, they didn't have a stunt rider that looked like him. They didn't. So in the beginning when he's being chased, you didn't see what he looked like, and he didn't really have I don't think he really like had much dialogue with her, right? He gets captured, he has a sword, and they take him away,
right?
Yeah.
I think it'd been great if, like, she tries to fight them and he, like, shakes her off. He's like, no, like, don't get hurt or something. And you know that he has, like, a thing for her.
If they had met up. Yeah. If they'd met up in the woods as he was fleeing and he was holding the scepter and went, you know, and I'm trying to remember now when. Oh, he
no,
went
the
back.
Scepter was in
that's
a statue.
Right.
Scepter
that's
was
right,
in a statue
right.
the whole time.
Yeah.
So it's like,
but
no one
yeah,
even
they should have
this.
Met up. Yeah.
So
the one thing that I absolutely loved in this, one of the funniest jokes in any of the turtle movies, just legitimately laugh out loud funny, is when Kenji comes to the present and he's in April's clothes, and Mikey just so nonchalantly says, "How did you get into April's pants?" It just, I lost my shit there. That line is so, it's the line and the delivery that is so goddamn funny. How did you get into April's pants? So, that this movie does have it, that going for it. So,
you know, that's it.
Okay. And I've got some more, but
I think I liked Paige Turco as April. I think,
yeah.
I think obviously the lady from the first one, I can't remember her name, God bless her. I really liked her. Judith Hogue is April. I know they brought her back in the new one as, I don't think she played April in the
cameo kind of thing. Yeah,
but she was. I'm like, glad, you know, glad, respect. I like Judith Hogue. This lady, the second one, I can't remember her. Just can't remember her.
Well, that's her. That's the Paige Turco. It's the same.
Is Paige Turco?
It is. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, I like her then in this one more.
She
than the
plays
second
it
one
differently. Between yeah. 2 and 3, like in now in 3, she's like a New Yorker, you know.
Yeah,
it's like just, when she's a reporter.
Yeah, wow, when it's she so go funny. when she goes into the past, well, her hair's different, and but she has this attitude, you know, yeah. this yeah. New Yorker attitude that she didn't really have in the first. Well, Judith Hogue kind of had
extent.
A
she had a New York yeah. reporter.
She was sassy, but yeah. it is a different character.
She was
choice.
Like 80s sass.
Yeah,
she was more like Sybil in Moonlighting, I feel like.
Mm.
And but so funny that I forgot Paige Turco was the second one. I could have looked it up. Right. I didn't. But like the fact that like I don't forget, because I feel like she just doesn't get enough screen time because they have like more characters. You have the scientist. You have your new kid who's like going to try to infiltrate the Foot Clan.
Yeah, and I think she kind of takes a back seat in the
and
second
she's back
one.
Seat. So I'm glad that they like brought in April and she yeah. was the fifth character. She was mm-hmm. the fifth hero. Of this film, and I just liked her. I don't know. I liked her getting aggravated with the turtles when they were just yeah. kind of like goofing off, and she's like, "Guys, like you know, trying to see." And when she says like, "You know, I'm looking for an apartment in Japan," like I know it's kind of a joke, but at the same time, like I kind of felt it was like a real feel bad for her. She's like, she's dealing with the fact that like I could be stuck here, like
sure.
in feudal Japan, yeah. because you guys. Are like thinking like trying to make the scepter is going to be an easy one to mm-hmm. let's just rebuild it with the blacksmith.
Yeah,
there was definitely moments where I really liked her thing. I felt the other Casey guy plot line too confusing, where it's like, okay, he was going to do a mutiny, but the mutiny was a thing because he's a spy for Walker, and he gets the thing so he can get equal pay. And I'm like, they should have done that. Fixed. No, it should have pick one lane with this guy.
Yeah, the whole. I mean, I love Elias Koteas as Casey Jones.
Yeah,
he's one
no
of my favorite. He's one of my favorite parts of the first movie. I love that he comes back in this one, and it feels like. I mean, because he literally like walks on it into the scene and is like, "I'm back," you know.
Yeah,
and he feels like he is legitimately.
Ready.
He plays it exactly like the first movie.
Yeah.
So it feels yeah. like it's a real like, oh, okay, this is the one thing of this movie. Nothing else really feels like it, you know, it did the first time around, cuz the turtles look different. It's a new and different April. Splinter looks different. Like everything just feels different. Except Casey Jones walks in and it's like, okay, I'm on board now.
Boys,
so he's like the
town.
One thing that I remembered from this movie. I was like, oh yeah, and Casey's in that one.
Yeah.
I still wanted him to fight them though. I was bummed out he never got to fight the Honor Guard.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, well the first line
for some
he's like,
I
he's
thought
like,
he did, but
well, the first
oh, okay.
line, he's
so
like,
I was waiting for it.
Yeah.
Wake walks
so then
in.
They just fight each other as hockey players, so
yeah, yeah.
That's probably what I was thinking of.
Another funny line is they break the news
in.
To
hold
him.
On,
that...
Hold on. He walked. No, because you're talking about Casey Jones. He walks in and he's like, "Why'd you call me? Are we ready to crack some skulls?" And you yeah. as a kid you're like, "Yeah!" And like, "Not mm-hmm. this time, Casey." And you're like, "No! No, I'm ready to crack skulls! Casey's yeah. here!" Like, you're like, "Let's do it!" And you're like, "I know, we gotta do this whole time travel thing."
No,
like, but Casey's here!
We need you to babysit, man.
I don't get it. Gotta call Casey to babysit? Like,
yeah.
Ugh.
Call Kino. What's he doing? Why can't
yeah.
he babysit?
Honestly, like, I do. It's like, it just sucks. Like,
yeah.
I mean, I it's like, And like I said, his Japanese in the past character, this pirate, it's too confusing. And it's like,
they don't pay it off either. It's why do we need him to play both characters? Like, if there was, you know, more to, like, we find out he's, you know, an ancestor of Casey Jones, like that. But even that's like, why? There's no reason to have him playing the same characters unless it's just so that April feels a connection to him and is more willing to, you know, trust him. But even if she didn't recognize his face, the guy is still a spy and is supposed to, you know, get in good with the other side. So it doesn't make sense to
become a part of the group. He's just kind of there.
He
acts like he's surprised that he's going to shoot and kill them all. Like,
right.
I'm like, you've been his right-hand man for how long? And a spy? Did you really think he wasn't going to destroy what's in front of him?
Yeah.
All right, now we're going to shoot you too. And then he's all noble all of a sudden. I don't know.
Yeah.
Pretty ham-fisted.
It's just an unneeded element in the movie that...
There is something... Oh, man. I like your idea about if it paid off. I think it would have been a lot better for if modern day Casey, something happens and he gets back to the future and all of a sudden like he pulls out something. It's a watch or something. And there's an engraving and he was like, what's this? Yeah. And he pulls it out and he shows it to April and it's like, tell April I'm sorry or something like that.
Just a family heirloom. Like, you know, maybe she gives him something in the past, something that would have lasted, like a ring or some type of jewelry. And then, you know, present day Casey says, oh yeah, check out, you know, my grandfather gave this to me. And it's that same thing. And it's like, you can tell that it has been passed down his family all these years and it came back to, you know, something like if you're going to make him the same actor, have a reason for it, you know?
Yeah. And I think the movie wraps up too quickly when they come back. I think we're allowed an epilogue. And I feel like Donatello, the first thing he would have done is like jumped on like New York library system. And he would have like researched like what then happened to Lord Norinaga. Like he would totally want to know like what happened. And I feel like we as an audience are allowed that payoff of like Lord Norinaga, like work with the villagers and like, you know, like and everything worked out great. Some way to like wrap it up because it's just like way too hostile at the end. They warp and we're back to dancing. It's like, no, you gotta figure that out. Like,
yeah.
Oh, let's not forget Blue Hawaii Elvis sweater. We do get that.
Oh, yeah.
Because Mikey's never going to laugh again for five seconds.
Oh, yeah,
like
I said,
take that out. Take that whole line about like, you know, like, oh, let's live back here. And they try to work it in this whole thing where it's like they're not respected in New York. They're not liked. And I'm like, well, we don't see any damn scenes. We have no scenes of you in New York doing stuff. So, like, we have to go off of, like, the first two movies where, like, no one knows that you exist or something, you know?
Yeah, they're still in this vague, people know about them?
Shredder.
Well, yeah.
We're in post-Shredder, and April never brings up what her news talks about Turtles. like, so it's just like, you know, because she's on vacation, so she's not going to talk about work.
Yeah,
she's not going to talk about anything. And then when Casey Jones and the honor guard go out in the city, and you know Travis and I, we talked about this earlier, but I thought that like wouldn't it have been great if like Casey Jones, I don't know, and the honor guard like stopped a mugging or they did something like cool and honorable, like he did just take him to a bar, like
his form of babysitting is being a vigilante. You know that would be awesome.
Yeah, that would have been cool.
Oh my god, like there's a bunch of like bandits, like once again they steal a purse.
Yeah,
and
recreate that
the lady.
And Central
like, all
Park
of a sudden,
scene.
Just four ninjas and a guy with a hockey mask walk out of the woods and they're like,
oh, man.
Not tonight, bub. And and they all have like hockey sticks and they all have like improvised like batons because the honor guard, they know how to work with weapons. Yeah. And they just, and like they, yeah, maybe because of Casey, they all like do like slap shots on like the guy's legs or something. I don't know. Like,
or well, this would have required I don't know what the budget of this movie was. Take them to a hockey game, Casey. Take them to see the Rangers playing like this live game they're watching.
Yeah.
And then they get on the ice and they, you know, cause a scene and he has to like deal with getting them out of there or some kind of like slapsticky.
They did that in Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure.
Oh, do they?
Yeah.
Then do what the audience wants and have them do a stop the mugger scene. It's at night. You can easily get a park scene and you get these guys all in improvised ninja gear.
Yeah.
Easy. That is super easy to do. Easy and cheap. They could just film, like, even if they're not in New York, they could find whatever city they are. They could find a place that looks like a park, have a lady and a street lamp, and that's it. Like,
yeah.
Come on, guys. Yeah. Like you should. And if you don't want to do the violence, just imply it. This bandit got his butt kicked by Casey and the honor guard. Yeah. And I think everyone would have loved it. Would be like, yeah, like Casey and the guy. And you get to think about it. You go, yeah, like that'd be a cool little one-off story. So, yeah. What else?
You can definitely tell, like, they keep reminding you throughout the entire movie, like yeah, we know current references, you know, because you get the swing, which it's like, okay, so this comes out after Wayne's World. And then Donnie later will say something about Adam's family. It's like, okay, we were post Adam's family, you know, just certain little things that, you know, are the
timely references.
Very timely. And yeah, are the things that as a kid, you're going to parrot and you're going to, you know, you don't know what they're talking about.
Did make me laugh, though.
Yeah. There's one that really made me laugh was the, seeing Nora Nagin just instantly saying Wayne Newton.
That's good. Yeah. No, I like that one. Donatello trying to explain the 60 hours thing, I think was like, don't try to add, like, I don't think in a time travel movie you need to add a thing like the scepter's only going to work. Like the scepter just worked. Like it wasn't like something special happened. And I think that's rough. Like the scepter just fell out of the statue. He picks it up. He and April switch. Like it wasn't like a storm cloud opened or like the Aurora Borealis. See, when they did the Aurora Borealis in Frequency, you're like, okay, Aurora Borealis, it's weird. And you know, there's and they make such presence. Like it happened in the 70s and it happened in the 2000s. And, that's how, you know, Frequency, great movie. You want to talk about a little time manipulation stuff. Worked, and it made it like, oh, well, it's the weather, so we don't really know how it's going to work or not. This, like, yeah, Donatello's like on the computer trying to make sense out of this straight-up magic.
Yeah.
Didn't sit right.
The thing I was expecting was when April is holding it, and I think she's unwrapping it, she's about to give it to Splinter, and it's right before it starts to go off and she disappears. She blows on it to get the dust off. And I thought this was going to be like a, activating the fifth element or the fire element or whatever in fifth element. Like when you blow on it, it activates it. And because it's got that little tiny wheel, you know, hourglass shaped thing in the center that spins. I thought if you blow on it and that starts to spin, then it kicks it into, you know, turns it on basically.
Yeah.
And that would be what forced this time travel. But yeah, there's no rhyme or reason to when it's going to happen. So
wasn't it just him reading the inscription and then it kicks in?
I guess.
Yeah. He read the inscription.
One person has to do it.
Yeah.
I don't think I'm trying to, open wide gates of time. I think it'd been better. You could have had it where it was like the inscription, maybe as like they were looking at it each time they looked at it, like the inscription, there was like a number and it etched and it kept counting down or something. So it was like magic, like in the handle, the scroll, like they could tell. And they were like, once this count down, we just don't know when it's going to count back again. So there's that unknownness to it rather than saying like timeline. So it made it more, you know, it made it more like we have to get the scepter rather than just we have to get the scepter and like we have to wait. Because I thought that scene with them waiting for it to happen and storm's picking up, it was a little like, yeah, you know, like it felt like an end of a Sliders episode or something. It needed to be a little tighter in what they were doing. Like, you get it all, we go back, or we wait for something. It was a little bit of both.
Let's talk about, like, when the turtles all kind of meet back up and basically go to the village.
Yeah, right? They separate Michelangelo, and I guess to get him in the village, but it does suck to, like, split the turtles up. It's like, we got enough nonsense going on where we have, like, Casey and Splinter separated from the turtles. Now we have, like, actual brothers split up? Like, come on, don't tease me like this. I'm a child watching this.
This wasn't Raphael again.
Well, yeah. There's a weird thing in this movie with... I mean, yeah, Raphael was definitely center stage in the first one and not so much in the
He was kind of off with...
Right. He had a side story with, Kino. I get taking Michelangelo off on his own in this movie, but then once they get to the village and they're all together, then they swap Michelangelo and Raphael and give Raphael the little side story with Yoshi and all that. It's like, you've already kind of set it up as Michelangelo being the one who's on his own kind of in this, like, just commit to it. Make Michelangelo, although it makes sense for Raphael to still be the odd man out. I'll go into more of that little bit, but
are you talking about the fact, like, Yoshi, like, they make Yoshi angry and Raph's like, no, you gotta control your anger. Like, yeah, that's good.
I like the Raphael Yoshi. I like all that stuff. I like that. Again, it's weird. It's like Michelangelo in the end is like, I don't want to go back because there's a pretty lady here, I guess, mm-hmm. but she's got a man, you know, and it doesn't make sense that Michelangelo is the one that wants to stay. It makes sense that Raphael wants to stay because when they first get here and the dust settles, he's talking about how it's nature. The water's clear. It's peaceful. You know, it's like he finds himself at peace here, and then he meets Yoshi, and he sees in Yoshi, like, here's this angry little dude, and I can kind of help mentor him and set him, you know, because it mirrors what happens in the first movie when Splinter is trying to teach Raphael, like, you've got all this anger inside, man, and you just need to, you know, obviously going to butcher how he says it, but he's like, you know, you need to talk to me and let this anger out or it's going to eat you up inside. And that's what he's trying to tell Yoshi because he sees that. And now he has kind of that wisdom to pass on. And, you know, it's of course it's a callback to that first movie with him and Splinter moment from the first movie, which is still one of my most favorite moments in a movie, you know, two puppets talking to each other about, you know, anger. So it makes sense to make Raphael the one that wants to stay. And it's kind of like at the end of the movie, it's both Raphael and Michelangelo, but Michelangelo doesn't have a strong enough reason to want to stay.
And
so
Mikey is the one that actually goes in and saves Yoshi.
Exactly. Yep. Yeah. Why not Raph?
He saves Yoshi. And then he's just kind of, but then he like talks to the girl more. And it's like, like Mikey, like she's spoken for, like that's part of the plot of this film. Like she's spoken for with Kenji. Like, and so it's kind of like, don't you be hitting on it. I mean, it's a funny line when he says, what's your sign? I like that line.
Yeah.
But I think it would be better if, honestly, it would be better if he played a better version of like love connection or something that between her and Kenji, where maybe it's like, she says that she can't really communicate well with him, and then maybe Mikey's like trying like what his like what, and he could kind of say shit where it's like stuff that he's clearly watched in like rom-coms or something that would have helped. But yeah, you're right. Like Raph saying, you know, because it's hard for Mikey to like Because Mikey loves watching TV and making stuff.
Right.
Mikey, that's not going to be back here. Like, you're going to be looking at, like, feudal art, and it's all violent. Like, there is no comedy back here. So, that's, it makes sense for Raph. Leo, obviously, he wants technology. And then Leonardo is going to, like, respect the magic and time passage it needs to keep the brothers together.
So, well, what I like about Leo is he's the one that's like, we can't decide to make someone else get stuck in future New York. He's the one with the, he sees it like it's selfish if we decide, because we are removing that choice from someone else. You know, if the four guys, or, you know, five counting Kenji, like, they don't have a choice if one of, you know, us decides to stay in the past. So Leo is the one that kind of points that out. So I like that he's got the clear headedness to, you know, show that, like, they have no agency if we decide to stay, and make that choice for someone else, you know?
I think Mikey sort of just, he expressed, like, the sadness and loneliness of the turtles.
Yeah.
It's just, he's always had, like, the hots for April and then the hots for this lady.
Yeah.
But he's never gonna find that, because he's the only Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle out there, and I don't know if there's a girl version or not. So it's kind of like, I got really depressed watching this because of that. I feel like we still live in a sewer, nobody likes us,
right?
And Mikey's like all alone and sad.
Yeah,
and it was just, maybe that came across when I was a kid and I was just bummed out.
Because
Mikey's supposed to be the fun, exciting one, but he was just like a wet blanket in this one.
Mikey's the weird one in this one, because I'm okay if they want to mature him up a little bit, but they can't really, they kind of want it both ways. They still want him to be the goofy, silly one, you know, pulling wet willies on people and, you know, fumbling with the scepter and, like, various goofball things that they want him to be.
But
why does he suddenly, like, Is he the morose one of the group, you know?
Yeah, that's some weird Pagliacci shit.
Yeah. So, I don't know. And there's that weird moment between when they get back. I guess it's when they all kind of meet back up in the village once Walker and his men are raiding the village. And it's that weird moment with Walker and Michelangelo. When they're, like, face-to-face, and Walker rides past him and stops and is like, did I just see a 5-foot-tall green person? You know, so he turns around and they have this standoff, and they even, you know, hang a lamp on it and say, you know, call him Clint Eastwood and make it this weird, like, high noon kind of standoff. And it's just a sudden stop in the movie, because, like, the music drops out, no one says anything for a minute, and then it just, like, nothing happens, you know?
Yeah, the pirate...
It's just weird.
Yeah, I don't know. The Western joke didn't... I get what they're trying to, but it's like, this is like 200 years before cowboy time.
Yeah.
So, like, I get he looks like it with a hat and on a horse, but there should have been a better joke, and it should have been on the boat. There should have been a pirate stuff. It should have been boat. I think Michelangelo would have a lot more fun if he did Hulk references.
Sure.
Or he did Peter Pan references. I think it would have been more funny. Honestly, I think a lot of problems with this movie would have been solved if they took their mistakes and they made a fourth film. And they really should have made a fourth film where we went back to New York. We get, now that we play with time, we can play a little bit of dimensions. Maybe we can start doing Krang. We can do some dimensional stuff. And then we could deal with other mutants that are not just, you know, we could do with, like, alien stuff and all this other dimensional stuff.
Yeah.
I think that would have solved a lot of the problems. You would have got the fan base back. You would have been like, okay, they're doing some crazy stuff, like the cartoons.
Yeah, show them trying to get back and something goes wrong and they open up a wormhole or, you know, get
Bring
a brief
back,
glimpse. Yeah.
Have that scientist guy from the second one, maybe he's working somewhere else, and, like, Baxter Stockman, and he's like, you can't do that, Baxter Stockman. That's not morally good or something.
Yeah.
You know, like... bring back a fan favorite that would have been easy, like meatloaf and mashed potatoes, like just easy, easy cooking that everyone knows. It's home, you know, and then you could just have Casey Jones and the guys do. And I think that would have solved, I think 3 would have been, because I didn't like 3 till recently, but I've had years to watch other Turtles projects come and go, yeah. cartoons and movies, and I have like softened to it, because I think just when I watched it back then, I used to be like, that's it, like Turtles are over, like they don't make Turtles anymore.
Yeah.
And we had to straight up wait 20 years pretty much for
right.
Turtles to like, oh nope, Turtles is not gone. And that's great to hear. Nickelodeon's doing Turtle stuff. They're always, you know, doing something. You got the comics. You got them like splitting off with Ghostbusters. You got them with Batman. That Turtles Batman movie, I like cried. Like the nostalgia, yeah. I called my mom. I said, Mom, you will not believe it. The Turtles met Batman. And they did everything that my 10-year-old self wanted them to do. They nice. Drove the van while Batman drove the Batmobile. They, like, made fun of the Penguin. It was like they made fun of pizza. Like, I was like, they did it, Ma. They made the perfect Turtles Batman movie. And I was like, I wish I had this 20 years ago.
Yeah.
Because it was just perfect. I was like, everything I wanted was perfect. So it's like, if they could have found a way to do something like that with that, all those hits, and did it after this film would be like, oh, it's a little misstep, but they did some interesting things. And I think back, and then people would have looked back on this and said, the Japanese plot's actually well written. It's a little complex at times, but it's a really interesting story, and it feels accurate to the times.
Mm-hmm.
And then the New York stuff wasn't that great, but they made up for it in the fourth film. I think that would have been the quadrilogy we would have talked about years from now.
TMNT Minute and Reverend Motherverse are proud to present a special podcast event, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Up From Below, a role-playing game played and performed for your entertainment as the fifth entry in the TMNT cinematic series.
Based on the Palladium Games role-playing book Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles and Other Strangeness, and featuring an all-new original story, art, and musical score.
Starring Adam Sheehan as Michelangelo, Scott Tofty as Leonardo, Chris O'Connor as Raphael, and Ralph Atanasia as Donatello, Rachel Gatlin as Alopex, and your game master, Sean Jaffe.
So this summer, tune in to Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles Minute presents Up From Below, the limited series event, anywhere you get your podcasts, and at TMNTminute.com.
I think I figured out the problem with the franchise, at least with these three movies, because, they made the mistake of aging these movies down when they should have been aging them up. If you think about the Harry Potter books and movies,
okay,
right? The first one, he's a 10-year-old kid.
Yes.
The second one, he's 11, and so on until he's, you know, 17 years old or whatever. Because your audience is, in theory, the same age as your main character at the start, and they go with the hero, right?
Yeah.
So the first movie, they shouldn't be dumbing these movies down each time. They should be getting, you know, the audience is growing with them. And of course, there's always a new crop of, you know, 8-year-olds to come in for the new one. But these movies should have gone up instead of going down. And that it finally dawned on me. It's like, why are they making these movies? You know, that's why, like I said, I mean, I love the first one. I'm okay with the second one. I didn't like the third one. It's because by the time I'm 10 seeing this, it already feels like it's a movie for little kids.
Yeah.
I guarantee that's why I didn't want to watch it.
And
again.
And your vibe is like, no, I'm a teenager now.
Yeah.
You gotta make them feel more like teenagers because they are teenagers, you butthead. Right.
So it finally dawned on me, and I truly believe that's the problem with this movie, and the same problem with the second one. Not to that extreme, because there were still, you know, touches of the first one, but I think that's what it is. So
there's moments, like I said, when Raph and Leo, and they're talking about like the seriousness of like this situation, you're like, this sounds like a mature conversation, and then their goofball antics look even worse.
Yeah.
It makes the goofball antics worse.
See, I thought the first one was the most well-balanced because it had the goofiness. Mm-hmm. But then they had that like rough scene with Raph injured and in the tub. And that sequence that was like way out of my league as like a little kid. But,
that almost, like, looking back, looks like a real, like a brave thing to do in a kid's movie is like just show someone horribly injured. And then like the, and then what's the next plot point? Oh, now they're father figures, like visiting them in ghost form, and they're pretty much writing him off as like he's going to die in captivity.
Yeah,
like heavy ass stuff, and like whatever moms complained about it, it's like your kids were getting some real hard knocks, and but they were like good hard knocks to get. Like it's about the brotherhood of these turtles.
And it ends with Shredder getting crushed in a garbage truck by Casey Jones.
What?
It ends with Shredder getting like crushed to death by Casey Jones.
I mean, that's, Casey Jones is like trying to skirt manslaughter on that one.
So that one was pretty hardcore compared to the, especially second one.
Yeah.
This one was a bit all over the map. Like,
Well,
it was trying to be a Shogun movie, and then it was trying to be a goofball movie. Like,
it's
then a time travel movie. It was all over.
It's weird once you get to like the end of the second act, and this is when they're finally debuting the replacement scepter, and moments after it gets destroyed, right?
Yeah.
And but because there's a conflict, we need a resolution. So 2 minutes later, they reveal, oh, we've had the real one this entire time. Okay, there's a problem that's solved. And it's like every time they introduce like a threat, they neutralize it like 2 minutes later because I don't know if they don't trust kids to like.
There's a lot of heavy
the thread going with like I don't know, all of it just kind of.
Okay, hold on. May I? I think I figured it out. Okay, I figured out a lot of things. God damn, I need to go back in time and fix this film. Okay. You could wrap up a lot of things because because Walker falling into the water and that bad sound effect. It's bad. Yeah. I would say like find a way to better do that. And then the way you fix the Wit story is like you do the actual part about the mutiny thing. You like legit go with the mutiny and then maybe have Wit and Walker, or maybe Walker gets Wit gets a letter from Walker saying like, I'll forgive the mutiny and I'll give you like equal share, but you have to do this. Mm. And then have Whip be like, all right, the men won't listen to me and I don't want to get left here in captivity in Japan. I'll do that. Okay. And then he gets dicked over by Walker at the end after he gets the scepter. And then Walker falls in the water. Show him swimming to the boat and Whip and the other men have taken capture because like they realize like Walker was just getting them in a bunch of trouble.
That works so much better.
Because they've lost respect for Walker, because they realize, he's putting us in danger fighting these monsters.
Yeah.
He's not taking... And so then they have Whit and him, and like have all those guys point their guns at Walker and being like... And have Whit be like, take him to the brig. And, you know, you could... And so, like, you would have wrapped that story up where it's like, okay, no one died. Yeah. But there was a... But now Walker is... He's lost his power.
Of doom for Walker, but you don't have to do the cliche thing in kids movies when you want to kill someone but obviously you can't, so you show them falling from a great height. Like every Disney villain dies from falling from a great height, or
and it just doesn't wrap the pirate plot point up much. The pirates still stay goons. I think it would have been a lot more redemption arc if Wit actually gets his mutiny, his real mutiny, and then him and Norris, like, and maybe show Norris, like, not looking so slobbish, maybe, like, like, he's like, Norris has a lot more respect for his job now, or something, and, like, he could be wearing one of, like, Walker's coats or something, like, show Norris, like, he's checking the buttons on his shirt, and it gives you that impression, like, he's just put this shirt on, and he's, like, trying it out. And then Wit's wearing the hat or something, so it gives this vibe that, like, by the way, since you've like fallen to the water, like all of us have agreed, like you're not part of this group anymore.
Yeah.
So then it would have fixed that line. It would have just given Elias Cody as just something to wrap that character up.
Yeah.
Because I felt like he was just two half characters. Casey really didn't get to do much. Casey just babysat. Casey didn't get to do what he wanted to do, crack some skulls. And then Whit didn't really get what to do, which was like a possible mutiny, or like right. or a betterment of his status as a pirate.
Yeah.
So it's like it's like whatever character arcs they try to get for our turtles, they definitely failed. Elias Cody is like, he should have been like, read the script, be like, so then what happens from Casey? So then what happens for Whit? And they're just like, well, you know, he's like, well, come on, man.
Yeah.
Like, got me wearing a wig.
I do like that. I don't know if it's in Elias's contract, but he gets to nonchalantly murder the enemy at the end of the film again.
Yeah.
Like, oops. He took care of the Shredder in the first one, and then this one, he just, I'll just cut this rope here and boom, knock him off there. Just a weird, maybe it's a trait he passed down to his ancestors.
It runs in the family.
Yeah, it's like, he fires the cannon, right? That's what it is. He fires the cannon at Walker while he's on the rope.
He blasts the cannon that shoots the yardarm thing that's holding pulley.
So he does do it. You're right. He does do it. He does, quote, kill him. But I just felt like, the falling in water and where was he going? Because it looked like he was on, like, where was the, we never saw the rope or the boat.
Yeah.
And I think it would just wrapped up. It's like wrap up these plots a lot better. And
the thing with the birds, like he goes back for the bird cage a couple times.
It's like that was like a third act. They add that in. Like, oh, we got to give Walker, he's got to have a fault. What's his weakness? Birds. Okay. He mentions birds a few times referring to April. Yeah. So it's like, I guess?
Yeah.
I think it just would have been a lot better. I think it would have been like, I would think it would have been so much funnier if it just like they were pigeons or something, and like people got, you know, like somebody got a message from Walker off of a messenger bird or something. That's another thing. The old guy, rather him playing stereotypical old Chinese guy, I'm old Japanese guy. Be like the splinter of the town.
Okay.
And have a scene where he and the turtles talk about some stuff. And I think that would have been a lot better. And he could have given them a history lesson. And I think it would have been a lot more respectful rather than him just being, oh, I'm just an old guy. Like, do something more to that. He had like two scenes where he's like, my grandson's in the house on fire. And then I kept you here. It's like, well, explain yourself more, old man. Like,
Have a scene where the four of them just miss home and they miss Splinter. So they sit down and have tea or meditate with this old guy for a little while, just get some wisdom from him I could see that, but well.
So I had a quick question here. I had a classic case of my memory fan fictioning. This movie.
We are doing that at this point. We are.
That's what this is now.
If we just recorded this and then filmed it, we would be making it. Yeah.
I thought this tied into Shredder somehow. Like, it was like Shredder's family ancestry or something. So I thought there was some tie-in with Shredder.
That's
surprising. Splinter's master or something. Mm-hmm. I thought there was a tie-in somewhere.
It should have, Patrick.
Absolutely just random.
Yeah. No, the fact that there's a turtle prophecy thing and, you know, Noranagi's family line should be the Orokusaki, should be that same family. The old man should be, what's his name? Hamato Yoshi, that family line. Like, they all should have been connected. In some, like, franchises, like, we poke fun at Star Wars because everything's connected. I think it'd be okay in this if you want to lean on this whole prophecy thing, then fucking lean on it, man. You know,
not just
make him
like
the Shredder's ancestor, and then make Noranagi have a suit of armor that resembles Shredder.
Yeah,
you know, and then that way he's a legitimate threat when they go to face him, and he's suddenly in his ceremonial armor and looks like a badass. You know.
Yeah, he didn't. He played it too comical, and the old man played it too comical. I was going to say this. Noranaga could be his own thing.
Yeah.
But how about this, though? Make the old man make him be Orokusaki's ancestor, but he's not an asshole.
Right.
You can have a whole scene where they're like, oh, like he's the ancestor of like Shredder. Like, we should find a way to like make sure that doesn't happen. And then have Leo say like, no, we're messing with the timeline enough. Like, we can't tell people how to like run their life. You know, something like that. Like a Back to the Future level line where he's like, no,
right.
We can't just stop people from existing because it's not convenient for us. Like, we, like,
well, then I'll do you one better. And I guess it doesn't work if Noranagi isn't connected. But if you make Kenji an ancestor of Shredder, then there's a reason not to let him come to the past eventually give birth to Shredder, you know? Like, make him, like, even though if he's a nice enough guy with a bit of a temper, like, then they have a reason not to want him to come back to the past. But
what if maybe the kid's name is Yoshi, but his last name isn't. So I'm just saying, like, there's a lineage there, and like maybe Mikey or Raph feel weird that like they rescued this kid and this kid's got anger issues.
Yeah.
And like Leo's like, that's like maybe it's our fault that we saved him. Maybe he was supposed to die. But like we shouldn't be affecting the timeline as much as we are already, or something. And like, you know, there you go. There's a little connection to Shredder. Maybe it's like they actually saved the lineage, in the timeline of Shredder. Like, Shredder shouldn't have existed, but they saved his family's village, and therefore like he exists now. Like, I don't know, is that too heady for kids with Turtles? But I felt like that's easy. It's something that's worthy of the franchise to mention.
Yeah, not if you do it my way and these movies get more mature as they go.
Yeah,
then you can do all you can do all that, like, you know, snake eating its tail kind of stuff of the turtles actually cause Shredder by letting someone saving Yoshi ends up, you know, causing Shredder or something like that. Yeah,
yeah.
Well, that and tying something familiar in with
exactly. Yeah, yeah.
Because as a kid, I'm sure I was like, where's the Shredder?
Right.
You don't have an intimidating. Yeah, you don't have an intimidating character. Norinaga, he's a jerk, but he doesn't feel intimidating because he lets his soldiers do the work. He doesn't really do any fighting. Walker, you know, he's like a pissant guy, but he's not intimidating because he's just a guy on a horse. Like, you know, the turtles have fought tougher guys. That he just has an army of pirates. So
he does a good job. The actor Stuart Wilson does a good job of being just nasty, you know. He reminded me of the second in command guy in Waterworld.
Okay.
Dennis Hopper's like right hand guy, kind of a real long hair pirate type guy.
Yeah.
Just real, just surly and just real nasty, you know. That's who this guy. Like, he's a good enough in that kind of role, but
yeah. But they needed they needed to raise some kind of stakes. Yeah. And not. Time isn't just enough of the stakes for a post-Super Shredder thing. Rather than just fighting, like, miscellaneous... Because I said, Turtles were kicking all of his soldiers' asses. Like, all of Norinaga's soldiers, they would whoop them. And, like, their shots were, like, remember Leo hands the soldier his swords? Here, take them. And he goes, bam! Like, right, socks him right in the nose. Yeah. And you're like, there. Like, the Turtles have... Like, they could goof off with these samurai because they're so well trained. They can be like, I will give you my weapons because I'm going to punch you right in the nose, you idiot. So it's like, I never was in fear. It wasn't until like, they had like 100 guns pointed at them that the turtles were ever in trouble.
Yeah. Well, that is one thing Oh, go ahead, Patrick.
I was going to say, that I think this movie's other problem is the scale.
Okay.
Like, I never felt like he was a warlord because it always felt like there's maybe 20 guys. Like, I never felt like he had a true army.
Yeah.
Yeah. 20 guys, and they were never a match for the Turtles.
Right.
Yeah. At no point did the Turtles... Like, the Turtles were barely... They were in the armor kick-flipping these guys. And that's great. Yeah, and that's the thing. That's another great work with the costumes and the stunt people. They did a great job with the moves. They did not cheapen out. Well, you get to see a wide shot of them doing high kicks.
Yeah, the fight choreography in this is really good. I do think all the fights and the action sequences are pretty decent. Maybe not as good as the first movie, but it's still, I thought it was pretty solid, especially the way they are able to move in those costumes and pull off like long sequences of like uninterrupted moves and fight, yeah. you know, fight movements and things like that. So,
yeah. And I
oddly found the worst fight to be the first fight we see on the horses with the swords.
Okay. Yeah.
Like, no, you're right.
Yeah.
Clang, 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 clang. Oh, yeah. We got you. That's it.
Right.
And they did the whole... What's funny is they had the stunt actors of Turtles later falling off horses, so they could have done more, like, horse falls. And I think
I was impressed with, the horse falls and stuff. With the... You got a guy in a suit, in a turtle suit, falling off of a horse, rolling on the ground and whatnot. And, you know, that's a dangerous stunt, you know?
Yeah. Not enough turtle bits. Like, actually them doing stuff as a turtle would do. Like, they don't do any aquatic, amphibious, like, sneaking in the castle through the water. We obviously don't have a pirate ship they sneak on. They don't do any cool, like, a few times they get hit in the shell, but, like, but it's, like, they don't do a cool thing where it's, like, they're falling, so they all go into their shells and, like, slide down or something.
Sure. They do the Leo pulls his head and maybe his arms. Kind of call back to the first movie with Michelangelo, but... Even that, it looked bad.
Yeah.
It just looked like a weird puppet, you know. I don't know. But
yeah, I kind of just pictured him like they had the shell in place and then he would just stand up and be back in the shell.
I think that's what it was. Yeah, you're right. He just had him like
his arms do go from way low to up high.
Yeah.
All of a sudden.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was the only way to pull it. They should have done was had the arms be static props and then just had him tuck his arms in and do a head up and down. That's what they should have done. It didn't look right.
And I did check real quick. This was the highest budget of the three.
Really?
Because the first one was like 12 and the next one was like 17 and this one was 21 million.
I wonder what they spent it on. I mean, the body suits look decent. I don't know where the armor was good. Yeah, the costuming's decent. I guess some of the sets might be. I don't know.
They don't go to, like, New York at all. They're in this,
no.
They go to, like, a sports pub. And
I mean, set-wise, they use their sewer or subway lair, which that's a couple rooms, you know.
Yeah.
Even in the feudal Japan stuff, the sets, I guess they have the village with that looked pretty good. That's pretty legit.
It's probably the location filming. Cause like, they're not in New York. They can't just all go to an apartment. They have to like, they had to probably like, I don't, wherever this is, do you think they filmed in Hawaii? Like, where did they film this?
I'm betting that's, Pacific Northwest. I think with as much Highlander and other TV shows set in the 90s that shot up in Vancouver, I bet it's up there.
All right, that makes sense. Once again, that would keep the cost down if they're filming there, and it was like maybe a 2-hour bus ride from here back to the Vancouver hotels. Yeah, it might just been that. It just might have been just transport and just building the sets and stuff in the Pacific Northwest. But you're right. Yeah. Odd. It's just odd.
I think it's Astoria, Oregon, I think is where they're doing all their outdoor stuff. Okay. So
with the Goonies.
I bet that beach is the same
Goonies Beach,
Goonies Beach, but
all the more reason they couldn't get a pirate ship, huh? We couldn't get a pirate ship.
Right.
Huh?
Yeah.
Dang it. At least like a deck. You can't build half a deck.
Exactly.
Like, you couldn't, like, you know, God, I feel like, I bet you the crew designing would be happy to build at least half of a boat deck to do in a cabin's quarters. Because, like, I felt like the temple and the insides, I felt like they were built well. So it's like, the set designers, more than happy to build a cabin's quarters. So it clearly was like, it just was not in the script. Like, oh, we'll just keep filming everything in the temple or the courtyard. And I was like, we're getting tired of these scenes. Yeah. Like, we're here, we're in the dungeon again. We're in the courtyard again. We're in the temple again. You know, like, show me a final shot somewhere else. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I didn't feel good at the end of this one. You know, they keep stretching out the Michelangelo doesn't want to go home. And, you know, then
he doesn't make it back though.
Right. Except he does, and it's fine.
A minute later, so the stuck in time didn't really happen. Okay, right. there was a mulligan timeline.
But the thing was all smoky, so I guess that's broke now.
Yeah, right, yeah. That was a nice thing to show, like it finally is going.
Time shenanigans are done, so yeah.
But yeah, there's no like, you know, now that they're back and they fixed time, like there's no epilogue to it. I feel like they wrapped up too quickly. Yeah.
They went with the splinter joke, you know, once again, and this is by far the worst of any, like,
yeah. At least it hit his face a little bit.
I guess.
It wasn't as terrifying to look at.
Yeah.
I think it'd be better if Splinter. Yeah, if Splinter pulled one of his books out and like read something, like I found one of my books, and he like opens it up and he reads a passage that says something about what they've done, and Splinter's like, "You did it, my sons," and they would feel, everyone would feel great. Like,
no, here's how you end it. Okay. Leonardo beaming with pride that he, you know, yet again like led his brothers to victory, that sort of thing, and he approaches Splinter and says, you know, wait till we tell you what happened. And Splinter pulls that book out and says, I already know. You know, he's read the story, so he already knows how it went down.
Yeah. And Leo would be like, master, and just be like, just flabbergasted. And they're all like, now they're all four of them are looking around the books, and there's just ancient sketches of them and like the village. Yeah. And
maybe this village now has statues to these, what, you know, now they're regarded as like turtle, you know, protectors.
Oh my god, the word flips from like demon to like savior or something.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. Guardians.
Like guardian. Oh my god. Yeah, because then they would love that. Like that word, they changed that word throughout history.
Yeah.
That word doesn't mean demon anymore. Now it means guardian. Oh my god, Travis.
I like to think Yoshi went on to make billions with his yo-yo that he invented, thanks to Raphael.
Yeah, that should have been the stinger at the end.
Yeah.
The it's Yoshi just, yeah, family just... dynasty fortune of
the yo-yo Yoshi.
Yeah.
Oh, dude.
It's perfect. It's perfect.
It honestly aggravates me. It's one of those things where you want to walk in like, guys, I've seen your script, and you've got to make it more fun, and here is how you do it. So. Yeah. I don't know. All there right, should be a small documentary about this film, because I want to know. I want to at least know like 40 minutes of why did it come out like this, and why does it feel rough?
Right.
Why is it? Why is the ending feel like they didn't know what to do?
Yeah.
All right. The longer it is, I'm glad you brought me on, Travis. I'm glad I got to revisit it, and I'm glad we actually were able to like plot salvage it, like
right.
a few tweaks, and you actually really could have had a banger. That people would be excited to go see the fourth film.
Yeah. Hmm. Well, let's.
Wild ride.
It. Yeah. It truly was a Turtles in Time.
The actual movie and what should have been, or could have been.
Yeah. Let's go around and let's figure out some most heroic and most villainous moments, perhaps.
I believe there's a hero in all of us.
I just finally know what I have to do.
That keeps us honest.
I'm here to fight for truth and justice in the American way.
Gives us strength.
You will give the people of Earth an ideal to strive towards.
Makes us noble.
And I know in my heart that it's right.
I don't even know if I can think of this movie that way. But
I think there's some standouts for most heroic, for sure. Yeah. I'll kick it off with the either saving Yoshi in the fire for Michelangelo, or moments later when Leo gives him, you know, mouth to mouth.
Yeah, that's. I would say that, and then third would be Raph teaching him, you know, how to like calm and focus on his anger issues.
Yeah,
those, each of them doing a little something for Yoshi, for not any payoff when they go back to the future. That is those are top three, I would say. Heroic,
I guess. Since that's kind of where I was heading, I'll say slim pickings, but maybe, I don't know if it's heroic necessarily, but just Mitsu not killing Mikey right away.
Because
to her, it's a demon.
So, yeah. I mean, right. Sparing his life. Yeah.
The villagers seem to be somewhat okay with him for the most part. I mean, I don't know. But I mean, I guess that's kind of heroic and not just straight away chopping his head off.
Right.
But yeah, there really isn't too many. I mean, the only other one I could think of is Leo standing up to Walker about being gutless to shoot him himself and that piece. But then it's ruined by the weird head thing. So
yeah,
it's hard to say that as well.
Yeah.
This planet, these people, they are nothing to me.
You were made to be ruled.
The universe is power. You, unstoppable power.
Come to me, son of Jor-El. Kneel before Zod.
And I am that force. I am that power.
In the end, you will always kneel.
Before your master.
Let's go over to villainous. I'll say Wit. You know, revealing his betrayal, because I don't think he's redeemed enough to be a hero in any way.
No.
He's just a dirty pirate.
Yeah, and then just, I mean, like, you know, Walker with the cannon, Walker just trying to essentially, like, also warmonger.
He's
trying to, like really, you know, he's definitely helping. Because, like, Norinaga, like, he wants to fight this war, and we're all like, why? But, you know, it's a warlord thing. But, but Walker pretty much being like, oh, well, you're not going to be able to do it without my guns. And, like, really trying to, like, making sure, like, if you really want to kill people, you got to do it with my guns and, like, you know, no prisoners and stuff. Like, so that is a lot of Walker, like, in Norinaga's ear, getting his foot in the door is what I would put as most villainous. Being like, you really should be killing more people. Like, that's
That is a good line when he's like, oh, and your prisons are already full enough, so we don't want to take any prisoners. So,
yeah.
Patrick?
I'll go against the grain here because I can't think of anything else. It's a personal vendetta I have. That would be the Ninja Turtles Wet Willy treatment of Niles, because it brought upon numerous Wet Willies, both at the end of this film for my friends and a few years after.
Yeah, I do kind of remember a resurgence of Wet Willies from this. So
a real life villainous moment from the Ninja Turtles. Inspiring those to do evil.
Yeah. Oh, man.
But yeah, there's not very good villainy in this movie. So
not really. I mean, it's pretty much all Walker. But yeah.
Warlording, you know? Yeah, that's evil. Yeah, it's like, it's evil. You know, it's not really a personal. But... it's like, unless your village is burning, it doesn't feel personal. And then it's like, oh, wow, our village is burning. It sucks. So.
Well, and he's got like 20 guys as an army and they can't beat some farmers. And...
right.
I don't know. I just never felt like they were really that in danger.
Because
it wasn't even the warlord that set their village on fire. It was Walker.
Yeah.
So it's like...
yeah.
I don't know. I was failing to see why this tiny village was causing such havoc.
Yeah, they really need to have a scene of... Shimi's, I'm sorry, right?
Which one?
The girl...
Mitsu.
Oh, Mitsu.
Mitsu. They really need to show a scene of, like, Mitsu being more, like, Robin Hood in the woods and stuff. Like, she kind of did feel like it. Like, she was the one that seemed to be, like, training them. She was... so, it would have made more sense. Like, you wouldn't have seen them so much as farmers.
Yeah, well, I think even Kenji says, like, she is the lead, the head of the resistance or rebellion.
Yeah.
But,
like I said, Lord Norinaga never was scary enough. He seemed too worried and paranoid. And you're right, I think there could have been a few things that make him more evil. He just, you know, seemed... like they're trying to play this paranoia thing with his ancestors and Walker's in his ear. But he never was intimidating, even when he fought Leonardo. Like, yeah. Leonardo, I'm like, dude, Leonardo is pulling punches on this guy. And then Leonardo takes a little bit off the top.
I like that. That's a good moment.
Oh, I like it. No, I think it's a good way of, like, Leo putting Norinaga in his place. Like, yeah, I could kill you. I'm going to cut your hair. I'm going to, like, just kind of, you know, tar and feather you kind of thing.
Well, what say we, let's rate it, give it your overall thoughts, and we'll get out of here.
I give it, like,
out of five.
I say, can I break it into fractionals? Like, because I want to do, like, a 2.9.
Okay.
All
right. Like, it's just making meh of it. Like, because I said, like, you know, a few of those points, we really could have popped it into the high threes. But it just felt like, I'm like, guys, you're the ones telling me this movie, and I don't think you know what you're doing. So, and I don't want to mark it straight two, 2.8, 2.9, something like that, where it's like high in the twos. It could have, it was close to being meh. If a fourth film came out that they learned from the lessons of this, obviously, I think in retrospect, we wouldn't have been as hard on this one.
Mm-hmm. So you're going with
2.9?
2.9. Okay. I'm going to give it a I'm at a 2 with this one.
Okay, yeah. That's
it's like, just like I said, you know, they aged this one down. It should have been the reverse. And I realize I'm not the target audience for this movie.
You were at some point sort of.
But not really, because even at 10 years old, I wasn't the target audience. So, and even then, I didn't like it. So, you know, and obviously, there is a target audience for this movie at, you know, Once Upon a Time. But I just, for someone that loved the first one, to get to the third movie and not be able to enjoy it, that's a big problem, I think. I think that, like I said, I think that's the core problem is, you know, they need to, by pointing these movies downward, just ruined it, I think. They should have been elevating them. That's a production problem. That's a problem with the studio and all that stuff. That's, you know, I liked the feudal Japan stuff. Like you, Dave, I think like you said, you know, they got someone, you know, was able to write a decent, you know, plot with some of the feudal Japan stuff. And that was overall mostly good. I like the fight stuff. I like that they got to use their weapons again. That was nice seeing them take on, like, you know, seeing Leo versus Norinaga with legitimate swords. Like, that's great to see, you know, especially coming off of how watered down the second movie was with, like, no weapons. So, but just, you know, performance-wise of the Turtles, I just thought they were such a departure from how great they were in the beginning. So, and maybe that's because you don't have, like, the Henson Company isn't really involved with the puppet, you know, the puppet making and all that stuff anymore. So, I don't know. I'm at a 2.
Yeah, I'll say ditto on the 2 because, I just don't feel like this movie knew what it wanted to be. Because, mm-hmm. Like, the Japan stuff, probably over a 10-year-old's head on a lot of stuff.
Mm.
But then their goofball cheesiness would be, like, more of a 8 to 9-year-old. So it seemed to miss the ideal range of, like, a 10 to 13-year-old.
Right. Like, yeah.
The group that probably they're trying to target.
I think it is a little weird that they, for some reason, the script felt they needed to do a big scene change. They didn't want to do New York anymore. Whereas I think the entire audience would have been okay if it was another story in New York. Just figure out a new conflict. So to do this dramatic setup of, like, ancient feudal Japan, which, yeah, it's over kids' heads, and it feels wonky because it's like kids don't understand feudal Japan. Like, we're not getting this in history class. We don't know why Japan's like this back then.
Right.
We're not going to learn about this until we're in, like, high school. We're gonna be 1670 before, like, we get world history of Japan. So this is coming in way too early for the kid demographic. And it would be better if they played it more like Hook, if they did more pirate ship stuff, like easier for kids to digest. Like, you can have the Japanese feudal thing, but do a little bit more pirate stuff in there too, and kids would be like, you know, I think kids could get more of a Hook vibe from it.
Right.
I will say the armor was still cool, seeing the turtles in the
yes,
yeah,
the demon mask armor.
That is probably like the focal point, is like how good they look. If they didn't look good in there, I think then nothing would have been redeemable, because you're just like, at minimum, you gotta put them in cool samurai outfits.
I'll say something positive there.
Yeah.
I mean, it's all right. I mean, I'd never watch it again.
Yeah.
I hadn't watched it since I watched it as a kid.
Right.
So
I think that's...
I think I thought it was going to be worse in my head than it was.
Yeah. Yeah. I think...
Because I had it like a TV movie in my head.
Okay. It was interesting because, yeah, I struggled with pressing play. Even Dave and I were kind of messaging right before I started watching it. I'm like, I guess I got to do this. And so I didn't want to start watching it. I just thought this is going to be so bad. And as I start watching it and I see that it's got some good photography and stuff like that, I'm like, okay, I started opening up to it. And then it started to, like, I'm opening up to this movie. I still hated seeing the turtles for the first time because they look like crap. But, you know, eventually by the first and middle half of the second act, I'm like, I'm kind of on board. And then it just was a steady decline back towards like, no, this is not good. So, yeah.
I'd be interested to see if there's like data on like iTunes as to how many people own this as a standalone versus part of the series.
Yeah,
like a Turtles pack or whatever, because I can't imagine anyone owning this on its own.
Right. Yeah, that's how I bought it, because like I said, when...
Oh, really?
Well, like, I think I mentioned it in one of our previous Turtle episodes, like when I went looking for the Turtle movies on iTunes.
That's right, yeah.
You could buy them each for $14.99 or a three-pack for $12.99. So you could buy the three movies for $12.99, or you could have spent, 14 times three? You could have spent, like, well over 30 some, you know, almost $40
nice.
Bucks.
To,
yes, it's this weird, it was this weird iTunes, like, algorithm, glitch in their price structure, that you benefit by buying them all three together. And I knew we'd
paying
cover
you to watch the third movie.
Exactly. Yeah.
So.
But now, yeah.
That's funny.
Yeah. So I guess that's Turtles in Time.
I guess.
Yeah.
I think we gave it the most fairest shake anyone's ever given this film. I'm serious.
Possibly.
I think we gave this the fairest shake. We didn't like initially shit on it. We were like, we're trying to find redeeming things, and
because it'd be easy just to shit on this movie. I mean, it's such low hanging fruit, you know. But
like I feel like there's definitely more effort in this than what Michael Bay did. Like, just from the trailers, I was like, Michael Bay, I know you're not even close to like what Turtles are. Like, I could just feel it from that trailer. I was like, I'm staying away from it. Even when you're like, Rocksteady Bebop in the second one, I'm like, no, I'm still not feeling the vibe here. Like, it's at least, you know, not me anymore. I don't know. I look at the Nickelodeon cartoons every time I go, that looks on par. I just like point to it and go like, I doubt they're doing 90s jokes. They're probably doing like, you know, Rihanna jokes, or they're doing like TikTok jokes.
I was just going
like,
to say TikTok.
They're probably doing jokes relating to like social media. Like, I'm sure like Donnie and Michelangelo are up on it. But still, I was like, I looked at the Nickelodeon cartoon and I go, the vibe here is definitely way more in line with what I felt, you know, Turtles and their kid audience should be like. So, it's just, I said this is a fluke, but I feel like in the long run, I've softened to this fluke more
right.
now that I see that Turtles was able to get its act together after the Bay stuff, and it looks like it's doing fine, and I think the comics are being, you know, they're back to being fun, and their crossovers with Ghostbusters and Batman were amazing.
I read the Turtle Batman comics and enjoyed them. I still haven't seen the animated movie. One of the things I really liked in the comics was like, there's this odd but fitting level of like respect between Batman and Leonardo.
Yeah,
because they're both like so disciplined, it's like there's just this level of respect there that, you know, they both appreciate in each other that I thought was really touching.
You're going to have a ball with that movie. Telling you, I want to watch that movie again. I want to sit my parents down and watch this movie and be like, like, pretend it's 20 years ago. Now we're watching it. Like, the Batman animated series, the Turtle series are just going at it. No, that's great. And the only difference is that, like, you know, that's Gotham.
Yeah.
But what I love about... Yeah. What I love about Ghostbusters, that's also New York. So, Peter Venkman and Raph trying to out New York each other is hilarious. Like, as soon as they explain where, their firehouse is, Raph's like, yeah, I've been to Tribeca. Like, he immediately, I know, I'm not from out of town. I'm in a different dimension. I'm not from out of town. Like, I just love that attitude. He's like, yeah, I can walk it. I'm fine. Oh, it's good. Stuff like that makes me laugh.
Hmm. Well, Dave, why don't you let our listeners know where they can find you?
Yeah, I'm over at 5minutesofmystery.com, where I talk about the 1999 superhero comedy ensemble Mystery Men, which is, you know, I was just talking about it in our Facebook group, where it's just like, you know, Captain Amazing, he starts by doing sellouts. And they're already talking about promotions for Verizon and Virgin Mobile for Avengers game. And I was like, no, the parody is becoming real now. Like, you're going to have Captain America and the Hulk wearing, like, shorts that have, like, brand logos on it. It's like, oh, no. Like, that's why I've been railing that's why I was warning us.
Yeah. Does no one listen to Dave?
No one listens to me. I keep saying, like, Captain Amazing is almost killed Champion City. So that's what we're talking about over at Mystery Men.
Very cool. Thanks for joining us for Turtles 3.
Yeah. I'm happy that the franchise is still fine. Like, this survived. They survived the Bay films, and they're back to, like, steady ground, and it sounds like Nickelodeon's doing good. So, like, I think that's the best thing to come out of this, is that, like, this is just a small misstep, but the Turtles didn't get ruined.
Yeah, yeah. The Turtles always endure, you know?
Yeah. That's what's great, is, like, they've gone, like, three generations now. Like, the Gen Xers, us Millennials, and, like, the Zoomer generation easily, like, all know Turtles. We all know the Turtles.
Yeah. Patrick, where are we going next?
I'm going to go to a film with slightly better effects, slightly better reception, and that would be 1993's Jurassic Park.
Oh man!
Whiplash ensue.
Oh, yes!
Hey, there you have it, man. That's something.
Yeah.
And after that, we fall back down on our face with RoboCop 3.
Yeah.
And I don't even remember RoboCop.
I've never seen RoboCop 3, so.
Oh, is that Ninja Robots?
How did you not see it? How did you not? I want to know how you not
I
see it.
I saw it. I just can't remember.
No, I saw RoboCop 3 at least four more times than I did 2 and 1 because it must have been so cheap. That's what they would play on TV. They would never play the first one, and they sometimes would play the second one. But they would always do, like, Darkman. I guess the Darkman sequels and, like, RoboCop 3. Hmm. And I was like, I watched them Saturday and being like, I don't know what's a sequel. Like, are they in the same universe? Because they're all both, like, schlocky. And I'd be, as a kid, being like, I guess I watched this. And then I watch Weekend at Bernie's 2, because that was always, I guess, clearly cheaper for them to play. Never play the first one. They were just playing back to Bernie's Weekend at Bernie's 2.
Yeah. Like,
okay. So, yeah, I've seen plenty of... Jetpack RoboCop and Robo Ninjas.
All right, well, hold on tight, everyone.
Yeah.
It's gonna be a bumpy couple weeks.
Oh, I guess I should say our scores gave this movie overall a 2.3. I don't think I mentioned that, but
I think that's fine. That I think if we watched the Bay films, I think they would probably have a lower. I think they'd be flat 2, because I just think. Like I said, I haven't seen them, so but I haven't heard. I never heard anyone do an essay defending them.
Like, they're fun for what they are. The second one is actually the second one. They introduced Bebop and Rocksteady, and it felt more like a cartoon adventure. So it was, I think, actually a little bit better.
I just know, I saw parts where it's like they're on a tower. There's a giant beam of light in the sky. Oh, like, we've done this.
It's all that. Yeah.
God, we've done this plot. Yeah. Like, come on, guys.
All right. I think that's going to be enough for tonight. Yeah.
All right, I'm going to have some horrible dreams now.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So
what could have been?
What could have been with Ninja Turtles? But I guess the next time we talk movies, it'll be Jurassic Park, something, you know, based on classic literature. So, you know, class up the joint here. And I guess until then, stay safe out there, citizens.
Since the beginning of time, man has searched the Earth for evidence of its past. But while some have looked for clues to the mystery, one man has found the way to bring the mystery back to life.
I own an island off the coast of Costa Rica, and I've spent the last 5 years setting up a kind of biological preserve.
Here, on this private island, science has defied evolution.
Where do you get 100 million-year-old dinosaur blood?
Genetics has mastered creations.
We've made living biological attractions so astounding that they'll capture the imagination of the entire planet.
And extinction is a thing of the past.
Welcome to Jurassic Park.
What have they got in there, King Kong?
None of these attractions are ready yet, of course, but the park will open with the basic tour you're about to take.
Hey, look at this!
You see something?
Dinosaurs and man, two species separated by 65 million years of evolution, just been suddenly thrown back into the mix together.
Can I touch it?
Sure. How can we possibly have the slightest idea?
Do you feel that?
What to expect?
Fences are failing all over the park.
Yeah, that's nice.
My phones are out too.
Gotta go.
Universal Pictures presents.
I can't get Jurassic Park back online.
An adventure 65 million years in the making.
Oh no.
This is just a delay. That's all it is. All major theme parks have delays. When they opened Disneyland in 1956, nothing worked.
But John, if the Pirates of the Caribbean breaks down, the pirates don't eat the tourists.
You sure we're safe?
Yes. Unless they figure out how to open doors.
Jurassic Park.
Thanks for listening to the podcast. Find the show on Facebook and Twitter at Real Comic Heroes. All music and audio are the property of their respective creators.